Good morning, councilors and guests. Mr. Speaker, is there a quorum?
Clerk. Yes, there is a quorum, Mr. Speaker.
In that case, we'll call the meeting to order, and we'll ask everyone to rise, and Councilor Steen's going to provide the opening prayer.
As we gather here today, as a member of City Council, we pray that we are ever mindful of opportunities to render our service to fellow citizens and to our community, keeping in mind always the enduring values of life and exerting our efforts in those areas and those things upon which future generations can build with confidence. Let us continue to strive to make a better world. Amen.
Amen. Roll call.
Mr. Speaker, Councilor Nordman, His Worship Mayor Cates, Councilors Brawadi, Edie, Fielding, Gerbasi, Havixbeck, Mays, Orlico, Pagtakan, Sharma, Smith, Steen, Swandell, Vandell, and Councilor Wyatt.
Thank you. We're joined today by our page, Madison Fettick from Glen Lawn Collegiate, who resides in the North Kildonan Ward. Madison, thanks for being here today. Councillor Smith, yes.
Suspension of rules to allow four more speakers on the grocery store and allow questions.
Well, you're a little ahead of the game, Councillor Smith, but are we prepared to suspend the rules so that we can hear four speakers in delegation, 5 minutes each?
Yeah, and allow questions.
Okay, we'll vote on first hearing them. All those in favor of hearing them, say aye.
Aye.
Those who want to allow questions, say aye.
Aye.
Ayes have it. All right, so we have 5 minutes with questions. Once we get to that portion of the agenda. Thank you, Councillor Smith. We'd like to welcome our guests here today, and I'd like to ask Mayor Cates if he has some announcements and comments. Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I definitely do have some announcements. First of all, I'll start off with, as many of you know, I'm sure that April is National Poetry Month and is being celebrated at council meetings in cities and towns across Canada, to recognize poets and the valuable contributions they have made to literacy and the arts. We've invited a local poet to read one of his compositions at today's council meeting. On behalf of my colleagues, I would like to extend a warm welcome to Victor Enns, a proud Winnipegger and member of the League of Canadian Poets. Mr. Enns will be reading a poem from his collection later on, Lucky Man, which was nominated for a McNally Robinson Manitoba Best Book Award. As well as, Mr. Speaker, I rise to convey the City of Winnipeg's concern for all citizens of our sister city, Chengdu, and all citizens of the Sichuan province. On the weekend, this region of China experienced a powerful earthquake. Our thoughts are with everyone in Sichuan province as they attempt to heal after all that has been broken and lost. I've expressed the City of Winnipeg's heartfelt sympathies to the Mayor of Chengdu, and know that all of Council joins me in sending the residents of Chengdu our best wishes. Mr. Speaker, as you can see, many councillors here are wearing the daffodil, including yourself. The daffodil is the Canadian Cancer Society's symbol of hope and represents the fight against all cancers, of which there are more than 200. Manitobans can show support for those living with cancer by wearing a daffodil pin, like the one I'm wearing today, throughout the month of April, and especially on Daffodil Day, which would be Saturday, April the 27th. I'm wearing my daffodil to recognize the courage of all Winnipeggers who have beaten this disease, and to remember those who have lost their battle, including our former city councillors, Bill Clement and Brenda Leipzig. Daffodil pins are available throughout the city for a small donation to the Canadian Cancer Society. I encourage all Winnipeggers to wear one to show those who are fighting cancer that they do not have to face it alone. And Mr. Speaker, this evening I have the privilege of presenting the Mayor's Volunteer Service Awards at Volunteer Manitoba's annual dinner. This year's awards will be going to some very deserving individuals and organizations, all of whom have made significant contributions towards the betterment of their communities. I would like to take a moment to recognize Pat O'Connor for his involvement with the Cordon Community Centre Board, Ken Cronson for establishing the YMHA Y Sports Dinner and his tireless fundraising, Peter McCarthy for his 40-plus years of dedicated service to his community, Fish Winnipeg for giving Winnipeg children the opportunity to connect with nature through angling, and the board and volunteers of the Garden City Community Centre for their commitment to improving recreation in the northwest of Winnipeg. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you, Mayor Cates. And at this time, we'll invite Mr. Victor Enns, poet and Poet Manitoba representative for the Canadian League of Poets, to read a poem. Mr. Enns.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, Mayor Cates, councillors. This event has been spawned as a part of a challenge that was issued by the mayor of Regina. And what's happened in response is that 20 cities across Canada have, during Poetry Month, had a poem read at a city council meeting. So I'm pleased to see that Winnipeg has joined in the challenge. There is poetry many, many more places than one might expect. On the way here, for example, on the side of the Ellis Cafe, there was a slogan or something that was written, actually, for people to respond to, which said, "Before I die." And then there was chalk and a chalkboard, and I guess people in the neighborhood were filling out a bucket list. To me, that's an example of public poetry, which was extremely moving to me. As well, if you ever walk by the Pan Am Boxing Club in the Exchange, another member of the League of Canadian Poets, Carrie Ryan, who is also a boxer, has her words on the outside of the building, or has had. I haven't been by recently, to be sure. So poetry is no stranger to civil society and has been around a long time, and I appreciate the opportunity to draw attention to it through this opportunity. When we came back to Winnipeg, like many Winnipeggers, I was raised in the province, educated at the University of Manitoba, honed my skills in Saskatchewan, but came back in 1991 to be with family. And we were looking for a place to live where we could have a bedroom for each of our children and a particularly good school. And we chose, in fact, the school first before we chose the place to live. And that was, in fact, Laura Secord School. And as it happened, there was a home in the neighborhood. And this, in some ways, this poem will explain a little bit about that as our kids were getting ready to start their education. At least one of them was younger. The poem is called "The Breakfast Table." The light has changed this Winnipeg morning. The sun shimmers before our children wrestle down the stairs with their belongings. The coffee grinder grinds up the remaining dark, fragrant beans from DeLuca's. The smell of coffee fills the kitchen. My wife appears in her white robe in the doorway, but there will be no hurricanes today. My knife blade catches the sun, slicing orange cartwheels. The boys ask for eggs, for omelets. I have to break a few. As they set the table, their sister yells from her booster seat, move me closer. Her brothers push her up to her place. It's her turn at the head of the table. Our Lenore Street kitchen sizzles as we join hands. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Enns.
And just a quick concluding remark. I didn't realize about the daffodils. There's a poem in this collection called "Tumor in the Fourth Ventricle" about my son that had a brain tumor removed in the hospital here in Winnipeg and is now radiating cancer. So he's a survivor. But there's a poem in this book, and I've left copies both of this book and the one that's come after called "Boy," which is actually a prequel about growing up in Gretna, Manitoba, available for city councillors. So thank you very much. Have a good day. Have a good meeting.
Thank you, Mr. Enns. You had my attention at DeLuca's Coffee. So.
Yeah.
All right, we'll move adoption of the minutes from our March 20th meeting. Councillor Steen moves the minutes. All those in favor? Opposed? Carried. Since we got going, our second page has joined us. So Midori Matthews from St. Mary's Academy, who lives in the Charles with Tuxedo Ward, is with us today too. Thanks, Midori. All right, we have several delegations to speak today. Two of them are with regard to the St. Bonaventure Cathedral restoration, and we'll ask Mr. Jerry Labossier and Robbie Gabor to stand by. Mr. Labossier, you have 10 minutes. Mr. Gabor, you'll have five. We'll take questions from the two of you together at the end. Mr. Labossier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, Mr. Mayor, distinguished councillors, distinguished staff of the City of Winnipeg, and distinguished guests. Didn't know what to call all of us this morning, but since we're all equal, I figured the word distinguished might be appropriate. We will be brief this morning, Robbie and I. I think there's been an excellent report that's been put together by the City of Winnipeg staff, and did want to start off with that, just like we did at the committee meeting, in thanking the individuals, John Kiernan and Jennifer Hansel, in terms of the work they did with helping us at the cathedral in terms of becoming a designated heritage site for Winnipeg. The whole manner and approach that they had, which was very collaborative, cooperative one, the professionalism that they exercised, I think was certainly from our perspective worthy of recognition. So I just wanted to mention that. We often forget about all the positives that happen in our day. I think it's important for us to recognize and talk about some of the positives that happen. So just wanted to mention that. We will talk about basically just a couple of points in terms of the grant proposal we have before you, that is before you. The first one is that, in fact, this is really a community effort on our behalf at the cathedral. It is a heritage site. And so with that, we've put together a heritage cabinet that really reflects different cultures, religions, and you may have seen that. I think that's been distributed, that you have a copy of that, of those individuals that are part of it. So I've asked Robbie Gabor, who is a member of our cabinet, to just describe to you why he decided to become a member of the cabinet. And then I will conclude it with a few comments on the report that talks about a vision that's evolving in the downtown area. And I'll just make a few comments, and then that'll be it. Thank you. Robbie?
Mr. Gabor.
Thank you. Mr. Mayor, councillors, for those of you who don't know me, I'm a lifelong Winnipegger. I was born in the old Victoria Hospital on River Avenue. I grew up around Grand Park Shopping Center, went to university here, and have chosen to live here and raise our children here. I was 14 years old in the summer of 1968. And I was in the field by the Grand Park High School walking my dog when I saw black clouds to the east. And they were big and they were ominous. And I could see some flames, but I immediately ran to a friend's house, a friend's apartment who lived on Taylor Avenue in Cambridge, and went up to his apartment to see the flames, which was the St. Boniface Cathedral. I knew that a terrible thing had happened. I didn't realize how terrible it was until the next day when I asked my father to drive there and saw the destruction of the cathedral. When Jerry approached me about a year ago to sit on this campaign cabinet, I told him I would be honored to do so because I remember what happened there. And I remember how the community was affected. For those of you who don't know me, I'm not a member of the St. Boniface community. I'm not a member of the Catholic community. I'm a member of the Jewish community. But I saw this project, and I see this project, as a major community effort. I'm wearing a pin for the Canadian Museum of Human Rights. That's another community project. So, my support for this and the other members of the campaign cabinet is based on that this is something that is important to Winnipeg as a whole. It's something that celebrates our history, and it's something that will bring the community together. Thank you.
And to wrap up.
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks very much, Robbie, for those comments. I just wanted to draw your attention to page 3 of the report. Fourth paragraph down refers and talks a little bit about what is evolving as a vision in the downtown area. And so we talk about tourism, we talk about economic drivers of what can happen with the museum. And I guess the component that's maybe a little slightly different, instead of looking at it as an economic development effort in tourism first, looking at it in terms of substance. So what is this all about? What's the museum all about? And what's going to happen with the museum? So it, as we've looked at it and have included different organizations as part of the discussion, that being the Forks, people like Jim August, the museum, the diocese and Monsignor Legatz and Boniface Hospital, lately as well, been joined by a few others that have expressed interest, Northwest Company, Upper Fort Garry. And the dialogue is really evolving in a manner that's consistent with a lot of the pioneers or some of the pillars of our community of the past. People like Izzy Asper, who had this vision of the Human Rights Museum, the Art Moros of the world, who've had the visions of Winnipeg becoming an international hub of peace. The Grey Nuns have been about compassion and communities and compassion all along. So underneath those aspects really are a lot of very similar common elements. And those would be around personal renewal, healing, building of relationships, building communities of compassion. So we've also had Winnipeg Foundation that's become part of the dialogue in that effort. So in looking at that aspect and what can be done with it, the cathedral obviously is an important component. So in addition to some of the restoration that would be natural to do and the roof and the, everything that comes with it, it's also the kinds of events that can be held. It's the kind of dialogue, it's the kind of discussions, it's the kind of healing that can occur if we have a vision and a master plan in the area. And that is what is transpiring right now. So we wanted to share some of that. And a quick snapshot of what that means is just a picture. An individual who's a youth, it could be your son, could be your daughter, could be somebody coming from another country that's 14 years old and goes to the museum, spends the day. And obviously their life is affected. So what we're looking at is really how can they continue that journey while they're here? And it could be individuals from Winnipeg as well. So that's where you start to see a picture perhaps of meditative paths of, you know, the Monsignor is talking about a healing garden where elements of Aboriginal aspects are brought together and integrated in it. Different elements where, you know, somebody could be sitting with an elder and learning how to forgive and how do I let go of things in life. So those elements would be part of the journey here. And also looking at some elements of how can they take some of these with them when you leave? Whether that's somebody like me who's there or somebody who's a youth and going back home in another country. So technology could become part of that. So again, picture 51 years down the road when there's the 50th anniversary celebration of the Human Rights Museum and somebody comes to speak who is now, you know, the president, Sarah is now president of a country in Africa and talks about her life and how what's changed the direction of her life has been this trip to Winnipeg that was funded by a foundation here in Winnipeg and the journey that she experienced and the little iPhone clips when she left that she could continue to connect with the stories of compassion of the bus driver, of the stories of compassion of, you know, the Jewish doctors who were refused work at a certain hospital and, you know, welcomed with open arms by the Grey Nuns, the stories going on and on, the Mennonites and so on, and the stories of compassion there. So there's a lot of those elements that could continue. We're also talking about events related to what could be done on the grounds of the cathedral, sound and light shows, elements that bring communities together. So that's trying to paint a little bit of a picture of what this vision could be. And in summary, probably this president of a nation in Africa might summarize it by saying, thank you, city of Winnipeg, Winnipeg, heart of the continent. Thank you.
Any questions for Mr. Labossiere or Mr. Gabor? Councillor Vandel.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. It's not so much a question as a statement, if you will allow me a little bit of latitude. I want to thank you, Jerry, for your leadership, your time, and your energy in putting this together. You've certainly put together a very impressive list of Heritage Committee members, both illustrious Winnipeggers and grassroots people. And I also want to thank you, Mr. Gabor, for the work that you've done. This is an important, it's not just a St. Boniface issue, I think it's a Manitoba issue, and it's really driven from the community. So merci beaucoup pour tout ce que vous avez fait.
Councillor Havixbeck.
Yes, Mr. Gabor and Mr. Labossiere, I just wanted to also say thank you for your efforts towards this. We have had a conversation about this in the past, and coincidentally, one of my sons happens to be on a field trip at the cathedral today. And so I think it's very timely that this be on our agenda, and you have my full support on it as well. So.
Seeing no others, well, thank you.
Good
luck with your project. All right, our second delegation for 10 minutes, Ms. Dorothy Clark, in opposition to the recommendation to receive the council motion from March the 20th as information. And we're going to also have four other individuals whose name I only have one of, Councillor Smith, so I don't know if you can scare those up for me. Anyway, you have 10 minutes. Thank you.
Good morning, Mr. Mayor and council persons. My name is Dorothy Clark and I live in the Kiwanis Chateau at 430 Webb Place. One of the best things the city did for downtown was putting in the walkways. My husband and I both use walkers due to health problems, and our main reason for moving downtown was the ability to walk without going outside. I live in a seniors building, and next to us is Fred Douglas Place. And many, many of our residents moved downtown because of the walkway and the accessibility of grocery store. Now that Zeller's has closed, it's a very big challenge for lots of us to get our groceries. So many of them do not have family to go shopping for them, or they do not have a car to go shopping for themselves. Many of them cannot walk outside due to using canes, walkers, and many other devices or aids. I know that City Hall does not think it should be involved in securing a grocery for downtown, accessible, preferably accessible via the walkway, but I, as a voter, think that this attitude should be reconsidered. Most of us seniors want to live a productive life without being a burden on society. Now that I have spoken about seniors downtown, there are many other residents that would benefit from a grocery store in the walkway. When Zeller's was in the basement of the Hudson Bay building, it made more than $6 million the last year they were there. I hope that all of you and council will reconsider trying to find a place and a grocery store for downtown. I am just one person speaking for many hundreds of residents downtown who need your help in acquiring a full-scale grocery store. Thank you for your attention. I respect your position and all the hard work you are doing for our great city. Dorothy Clark.
Thank you, Ms. Clark. We'll now ask Ross Dobson to come forward. We'll ask Mr. Ross Dobson to come forward. We'll have all the questions at once, okay? All right, so stand by. Mr. Ross Dobson, there you go. Mr. Dobson, you have 5 minutes.
Good morning.
Morning.
My name is Ross Dobson. I'm here with Richard Wilson, Conrad Artabese, and Berna Phillips, and of the Downtowners Grocery Coalition. Our committee speaks for residents of Kiwanis Chateau and Fred Douglas Place, which are 55 plus residences adjacent to Portage Place and connected to the downtown skywalks through Portage Place. In turn, we are a committee of the Downtown Community Residents Association, a body that represents apartment dwellers, condo owners, people who work and more significantly live downtown by choice, people who don't want to put the car at the center of their lives, but want to live, work, and play in an exciting and vibrant urban atmosphere. We have come to the belief that your vision of downtown development, Winnipeg's vision of downtown development, is focused on entertainment venues for visitors rather than developing downtown for the people who choose to live there. We want to change that. We want a vibrant downtown. You want a vibrant downtown. And what you need to develop that downtown in ways that draw people to live there, not just to visit, is to provide all the basic amenities they need. The only way to develop downtown, the downtown you want, active, vital, and safe, is to double or triple the permanent residential population, which is now at some 27,000. And to attract those permanent residents, you need to ensure that they are amenities and services that any community needs, close by, accessible, and part of the downtown community. Food services, of course, are basic. The food services that downtowners can walk to 2 or 3 times a week. We moved downtown so that we could live that way, walking to the concert hall, walking to restaurants, walking to movies. And we want to walk out also for our groceries as we need them. Until this spring, we could do that. A full-service grocery store was there for us. And it was profitable. It closed for reasons of corporate politics, not for lack of customers. What we are asking you to do today is to commit to finding out ways that you can secure another full-service grocery downtown. Convenience stores, and there are lots of them in the downtown area, just don't do it for us. They're very costly, and they focus on junk foods, not basic amenities. We've done our research, and we know there is an opportunity for the right aggressive young grocer to establish a fresh department, full-service grocery downtown. But the initial setup costs are about $1.5 million to $2 million for such a grocery store. And the rents need to be under $10 per square foot. This is where the city can help, getting this young man or woman started. The motion before you, or which will be before you, asks you only to do the research that you need to do to be comfortable with thinking about providing that kind of help, as other cities have. New York is the prime example. There are many other American cities have done this, and I think Hamilton in Ontario has done that. So we ask you, please, to help us and to vote for this motion, to start informing yourself towards starting a development of downtown Winnipeg, which is for the people who live there. We're asking you only to inform yourselves. Richard?
Richard Wilson. You have 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, Mayor, Councilors. My name is Richard Wilson. I'm also involved in the Downtown Grocers Coalition. We've put a lot of effort into analyzing ourselves what the reasoning is why we don't have a full-service grocery store coming in downtown, especially since the council obviously was aware over a year ago that this process was happening, where these stores were disappearing. As of late, I have talked to several people and I keep getting this question thrown at me like, we didn't know it was happening. Well, I beg to differ. I'm just a resident downtown and I knew over a year ago that it was happening. Living downtown was a decision on my part. I moved in from the country, had a back problem, had to have an operation, and decided if it went the bad way, I should be someplace where I can get easy access, still be independent, still do my grocery shopping, etc. Over the last 25 years, I've seen all the promotions the city has done in regards to come on downtown. Downtown is the place to live. We have all the support, all the facilities, everything is here. I'm very lucky. My back happened to be okay. I've had people mention to me, well, there is a full service grocery store. It's over on the corner of Donald and Broadway. From where we live, that's 11 blocks, one direction. Can anybody see somebody like Councillor Harvey Smith walking the 11 blocks over there and back with a bag of groceries? The second problem with that store on that corner is the fact that you can go there today and you can buy a 2-liter chocolate milk for $4.60. $4.60. Walmart will sell the same thing to you for $2.50. So consequently, with, I guess on the Winnipeg's homepage, they advertise the fact that there's lots of grocery stores downtown. There are not lots of grocery stores downtown. They're convenience stores, high-priced convenience stores. I don't know how many of the councillors actually live downtown. I assume there's very few of you that live in the downtown location to appreciate what the downtown residents are going through at this point. On the way out this morning, I happened to stop by one of our little drop boxes, and this is a package of signatures that say, yes, I want a full service grocery store in our neighborhood. This is from one location only. There are lots of other locations being activated as we speak. The Downtown Grocers Coalition at the present have people involved with us such as Alan Weiss, Fred Douglas Residents Association, the Kiwanis Chateau Residents Association, Place Promenade Residents, Harry's Foods, Stan from Harry's Foods. He's amazed that somebody has not jumped on this ability to put in a grocery store downtown right now. He said if he was 15 years younger himself, he would do it, but he wants to retire. University of Winnipeg students are behind us. The DCRA, the Downtown Community Residents Association, are behind us. David Stone from Portage Place, we had a talk with him. He has major area over there that is very suitable for a grocery store. Why there is not some kind of an incentive or some direction for a place like Portage Place, which was made originally to be the place to go downtown, why there is not some more effort being put into that. We've also checked out Federated Co-op to actually come downtown. There are reasons why co-ops would have a hard time downtown, and the main reason is $30 a square foot for retail for a grocery store. It doesn't work for a grocery store. Grocery stores are very limited in the profits that they make. They got to do such a high turnover. Zeller's, Stefano Grande said that the Zeller's store produced $6 million in groceries, $2 million in staple goods, and that was increasing. So for to say that we need to analyze the downtown, if we need a grocery store, do you need a grocery store? Everybody here, anybody that is in this room today, knows that we do need one.
Thanks,
thank
Mr.
you
Wilson.
For your time.
You bet. Myrna Phillips. You have 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, Mr. Mayor, Council members. I also live at Fred Douglas Place on Bond Street and moved there again because of the convenience and having been a long time inner city resident, both in the West End and Wolseley, That's where my heart is. Many people say to me, aren't you afraid living downtown, walking around downtown? And of course, all of us who live at Fred Douglas Place are great advocates for people living downtown and enjoying all the amenities that we have downtown. And we're very supportive of all the efforts that the city has made to encourage activity downtown. When we see new construction happening and housing being proposed, the only thing missing is a full-service grocery store. I was listening to your prayer this morning and noted that one of your resolves is to provide for the necessities for people of the city. And there's nothing more necessary than food. I sit in my balcony and I watch people go by, and we have wonderful demographics. We have elderly people, young people, students, Aboriginal people, immigrants, who all live in our neighborhood, many of whom are on low income or fixed income and have no access to automobiles. They can't make it all the way to River and Osborne to the Safeway. We need something within the walkway system so all these people can provide for their families in a healthy way. You can't provide for your family shopping at a convenience store. In fact, last night I was cooking and I had thought I'd got everything on the recipe. I had no fresh cilantro. Where do I go at 5 o'clock at night for fresh cilantro without jumping in my car and wasting all that gas, wasting my time, when before I could have just scooted up the block to the bay and picked up any of the fresh ingredients that I needed. Happily, over the years living in Wolseley and the West End, paid my taxes, which I recognize subsidized the growth of the city, and am very proud that our city has grown the way it has. But we have, over all those years, those of us who are seniors living in our block, paid for all the infrastructure out to all the suburban neighborhoods. And as I say, happily so. We are now asking if you could return the favor, those of you who represent suburban ridings, to support us in our effort to get a full-service grocery store downtown, whether it means having a committee to work with our committee to explore the options. If it comes down to helping us with a subsidy for the rent at Portage Place, if you could at least pitch in and help us come to a satisfactory resolve of this very, very serious issue. We appreciate your concern and we appreciate your support. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Phillips. And our last delegation, 5 minutes for Conrad Arterbees. Mr. Arterbees.
Good morning, Mr. Speaker, Mr. Mayor, councilors. Thank you for allowing us to speak to you today. We appreciate it very much. My name, I've been introduced, is Conrad Arterbees. My position in all this, I am the chairman of the Kiwanis Chateau Residents Council. And I'm here, I guess, as a closer. I just hope I throw the right pitch. I moved here just slightly less than 2 years ago. My wife and I had lived in Dauphin most of our lives. but we came to a point where we had to start looking at other places to live. We needed family. There's family here. We needed fairly easy, accessible to services, healthcare, and so on and so forth. Many of you know exactly what I'm talking about. So about 3 years ago, we started our search. We came into Winnipeg a couple of times, visited a number of life leases because that's the institution we thought we would like to live in. And we narrowed it down to what do we want? Well, we want to be fairly close to family. We want to be able to access events that are happening in the city. We wanted fairly easy access to health care and those kinds of services. And we also wanted fairly easy access to resources such as a full service grocery store. We visited a few suburban places, we visited some inner suburban places, and we ended up at Kiwanis, and it met our needs. It had all the things that we wanted. This is 2 years ago. It had a grocery store we could walk to when we wanted to and all the other kinds of things. At the time we were moving in, my wife and I both drove. My wife no longer drives. Therefore, we're down to one car, one driver. And now that we don't have a downtown full-service grocery store, I guess that's what I do at least once a week. Because we're rural people, we're used to shopping once a week. We don't go every day. We're not used to convenience stores. We're not used to all those other kinds of things. We want to go out, get our groceries, go home, and exist for a week. And that's why we moved downtown, and I'm glad we did. However, economics and business got in the way. Zellers got sold. The Bay portfolio, money portfolio, decided to sell it off. And one of the things they couldn't do is leave the grocery store in the downtown area. I'm here to say we chose to be downtown because of the choices that I've listed to you. I'm here to say that I think they're important. I'm here to say, and this is my personal opinion, that it is important to us now. It's important to 20-some thousand people who live in the downtown core that there is something like that available. People saying, well, there's lots of groceries around. Well, one of the previous speakers spoke about the costs of going to some of these grocery stores on some basic items. And I think we have to look at, as a community who wants a vibrant downtown, the roots of which are people, people like us who have no intention of going anyplace else except where we are, of taking part in the activities that are available to us, no matter within the downtown region and close by. And therefore, I'm asking very seriously that we all of us, the city of Winnipeg, the people of Winnipeg, the suburbs of Winnipeg, the downtown core of Winnipeg, look at somehow or other developing a plan where we can have, tied to the downtown core, easy forget. I'm sure many of you saw the picture that was in the Free Press here twice now about the gentleman walking across Portage Avenue. And he was proud he could walk across Portage Avenue to Zellers. Why? Because he could do it by himself and he didn't have to depend on anybody else. And I think that's crucial to people of my generation, that we can be as independent as we possibly can. We know someday we're not going to be able to do that, but I know that gentleman, and he was proud he can do that. He can no longer do that anymore. He can no longer go and get all of the things he needs in one place, whether it's daily or bi-weekly or whatever. He can't do that. Therefore, I ask you very much, councillors, Mr. Mayor, to consider somehow or other working out a plan with us and with the citizens of downtown to develop a plan that we can have within not the foreseeable future, but within the nearby future, some availability of a full-service fresh food grocery store. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Mr. Otterbees. If all of the delegates would like to come forward, do we have any questions? Councillor Eadie.
Thank you, Speaker Nordman, and I'd like to thank all of you who came to present the case for the city getting involved with trying to establish a full-service grocery store in an area that we could basically call it a desert. And so I really appreciate it. I think you, for me at least, you've made the case as to why the city of Winnipeg should play a role. We know that Center Venture and the Downtown Biz and others are involved in trying to figure out how to do this. But I think you made a case as to why the city should be part of it. But I have one question that's really important, because this in introducing this motion, I was concerned as well about desert areas, lack of grocery shopping in other areas within the inner city, as it seems that the suburbs get all the big box stores where the groceries are cheap. Do any of you know, like with New York, when they make a case for subsidizing, how many people, what kind of density do they require for a store? Like how many people? I think in downtown we have 27,000, but what is their rationale?
Mr. Wilson.
Sorry, excuse me. I could speak to that if you'd like. I actually have a printout from the New York group that did their analysis of their area. And this is one quote out of part of their group. The city is a built environment and stores no larger than 30,000 square feet can be developed on most local commercial corridors. Existing average citywide ratio for local grocery stores to people, 15,000 square feet for 10,000 people. The city planning standard for New York, the ratio for local grocery store to people is 30,000 square feet for 10,000 people. That's a large grocery store, very much larger than anything that we've had downtown. And this is how New York has managed to turn around some of their neighborhoods. And if they're using that type of an analysis there, in our situation with our downtown group right now, we have 27,000 people in the downtown area, which is definitely, if New York can see a way of putting in a grocery store for 10,000 people, there is no reason we shouldn't have one for 27,000. Thank you, Russ.
Second question, no?
Just a follow-up question.
Okay, yeah. One.
Ms. Clark, can you... I'm wondering if you can, I think it's really important. I believe that we really need to understand. Can you specifically tell us why the city should look at trying to subsidize to make sure that we can get grocery stores into areas where there's no groceries allowed?
Well, it's not only downtown, but most of the people who live outside of downtown, I won't say all of them, but most of them have cars to get to a grocery store. But most of us seniors who live downtown, we moved downtown because we couldn't drive a car anymore. So we have a difficulty getting to grocery stores. Especially, Mr. Eadie, I've spoken to you because I lived on Smithfield and Jones and you used to walk by our place. We're very proud people and we want to continue to be proud people and support ourselves. So in order for us to do that, we need to be able to buy groceries at affordable prices. So, you know, I would encourage the city to help us get a grocery store. And somebody says we don't have any place downtown for one. But a couple of years ago, there was a fire in the promenade. And the Aboriginal Learning Center has not been used since then. So why can't we consider going to them? The place is empty. It's empty and has been empty for more than 2 years. I want to say that this is you can access it via the walkway from outside. So it would be a perfect thing. I think it would be something that you could consider when you're doing your study. And thank you, Mr. Eadie.
Mayor Cates.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. First of all, to Dorothy and Ross and Richard and Myrna and Conrad, thank you very much for being here today. I don't think there's a member of council who doesn't believe that there is a need for a full-service grocery store. I think we all know that a major void has been created. Dorothy, you very specifically said that you know that City Hall believes they should not be involved in finding a new. I don't think that's accurate, okay? Because what we have done is we have communicated with CentreVenture, who basically is an arm of the City of Winnipeg, and as you probably are aware of, they and other stakeholders have got together. They've actually hired a professional to basically try and figure out how to address the problem. And I think you've actually, I think Ross, it was you who said earlier, you know, people talk about, yes, there's a full-service grocery store, but it's on Donald and Broadway. That's not going to help someone who's 6 blocks or even 12 blocks away from it. And that is part of the challenge that we face in our Winnipeg downtown. We have one of the largest downtowns in North America. And as you can see, and I'm of the opinion, it's going to take more than one, it might take two, it might even be three that are necessary to basically accommodate the public. And I've already gone on the record, and my opinion is what we should be doing. We should give one of these young, energetic entrepreneurs a building and charge him no rent, just pay a percentage of gross. So that way you don't have to worry about the $30, the $20. You do well, you pay your rent based on what you sell. You don't do well, then you're not paying. And to me, that is one of the ways of doing it. But in the meantime, CentreVenture and the professional are looking to see if there are people who want to do that. No one here that I know of is in the grocery business. So number one, you've got to find someone, and it's too bad Stan has retired, find someone who wants to do it. And then number two, make sure the amenities and the opportunity is there. And that's exactly what we believe CentreVenture is doing. So I don't think anybody here disagrees with what you were saying.
Councillor Smith.
I'm going to answer you because you know I've emailed you many, many times. And the reason I made that statement is until CentreVenture got involved and the other people in the community, I don't believe most of City Hall, I don't know, I shouldn't say that, but I don't believe that you really were considering the plight of the seniors downtown. And that's why I said that to you, and that's why I said it today, because I don't think that you became interested until a number of people got involved. And I apologize to you, Mr. Mayor. I have emailed you many, many times.
Follow up, Mr. Speaker. Sure. First of all, there's no need to apologize. I appreciate you expressing your opinion, and that's, we're here to listen. But most importantly, just for the record, you should know that CentreVenture got involved because we identified that problem through many reasons, and as you're aware of, there was talk about the Zeller situation for quite a while. There was also the rumor that there were going to be other tenants in that building and Zeller's were going to stay with a couple floors and the grocery store. That's all changed now. So right now I think we have defined the problem, and CentreVenture with all the stakeholders are going to find the solution. And it won't be an easy one. I personally believe multi-facilities are going to be needed to address all the concerns of the people. But thank you very much for being here today.
Councillor Smith.
I don't have a question, but I do want to thank you all for coming to make us all aware of the serious problem without having a grocery store downtown. Thank you.
Thanks, Councillor Smith. Councillor Gerbasi.
thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'm sure we were all really pleased to hear the comments the mayor just made that he's actually is open to incentives for grocery stores, because this is the first I've heard of that as well. I don't know if you've heard that. And at EPC last week, what we heard was that it was not a responsibility of city government to be involved in this, which not everyone agrees with, but that's what was said last week. So I guess I wanted to ask if you could respond to that. I'm happy to hear that, and I'm thankful if we are going to get involved, but it just seems like it isn't all that clear, so I don't know.
If I could say something, Jenny, in regards to this, I think a lot of the stuff has to go back to what the Mayor Cates just said about the Center Venture, the downtown biz getting involved. Those are the first people we went to when this started happening, when the Zeller started closing down. The original take on this was Amazing Surprise at that point, like total surprise that this was happening. And, well, we're going to start doing an analysis. We're going to send out surveys. We're going to do this. We're going to do that. They're all out there. But we do know it is a viable operation. Why all the analysis? Mr. Cates, I'm sure that you're aware that Portage Place itself, there's one position in there alone, 17,000 square feet that is becoming available within the next 2 months. A perfect place to put something. All we need to get it in there is an incentive for them to go in there. Not the $30 a square foot, but $10 a square foot for whatever length of time. Get people into it. If you put that out to any of the major grocery stores or any of the, like you say, the entrepreneurs, I'm sure somebody would jump on it. Thank you.
And that concludes our questions. Thank you very much. Thanks to the delegates. Enjoy your day. All right, that concludes our delegations, and we will then proceed with the report from the Executive Policy Committee dated April the 3rd. Mayor Cates.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I will introduce the report and move adoption of consent agenda items 1 to 9.
Two, please.
Stand down number 2. So we have consensus on 1 and 3 through 9. All those in favor? Opposed? Carried. Item number 2.
Item 2, incentives for location of grocery stores in grocery shopping deserts.
Mayor Cates. Mr. Speaker, I would very much love to hear what Councillor Eady or any other councillor has to say, and then of course I'd be happy to address it.
Councillor Eady.
Thank you. I'm not sure if it's in order to move a motion to send it back to EPC, but anyway. Is it okay to do that? I'm wondering if it's in order for me to move a motion to send this back to EPC so that it could be considered not just for downtown, but also for other areas within the inner city that are experiencing or potentially will experience grocery deserts.
The proper procedure, Councillor Eady, would be have it written out, have it seconded. You know, we can't do it on the fly here. It has to have paper.
It's just a simple motion to move to send it back to EPC for consideration.
Point of order, I think it's simply a motion to refer. You can stand up and simply say, I'd like this referred back, unless the clerk is ruling that we cannot just simply refer something back. So if I think that's pretty straightforward. It doesn't have to be written.
I know. Order, Mr. Speaker. What was asked here is to add something else to a previous motion, which in my estimation would be a new motion. Bring it forward, it'd be an automatic referral and automatically go back through the process.
Point of order, Mr. Speaker. It already refers to the other neighborhoods in the motion. It's not changing the motion, and I believe the mover agrees. Great referral of the existing motion. Just for clarification.
Okay, what we can do is, if we want to simply refer this back to EPC without instructions, then we can vote on it right now.
Yes.
Okay, fair enough. All right. All those in favor, please rise.
Councillors Eady, Gerbasi, Orlico.
All those opposed, please rise.
His Worship, Mayor Cates, Councillors Fielding, Havixbeck, Mays, Pagtikan, Sharma, Steen, Swandell, and Mr. Speaker, Councillor Norman.
3 to 10. Vote, Mr. Speaker, yeas 3, nays 10.
The motion to refer it back to EPC is defeated. And you speak to the report.
Yes.
Go ahead, Councillor Eady.
Thank you. Well, I have to say, I move this motion because it's very clear why full-service groceries are very important to the people who live in our city. And it just so happens that people who are living in the suburbs get to experience the benefits of having big box stores with full service, cheaper prices, so that they can afford to take care of their families and ensure that, hey, maybe they save a little money so they can pay the property tax increases that we passed along in the budget. So what needs to happen in the inner city is we need to make sure that we have a plan in situations where we have grocery store deserts and we cannot, and the people cannot get their proper foods for their family, for themselves. There are seniors who continue to live in their homes throughout this inner city as well, and this is why it's important. We heard that New York City sees the benefit, and Hamilton sees the benefit of ensuring that the population is well fed and so that they can experience well-being and be able to live in neighborhoods and afford to pay the mortgages and so on. And I don't understand why we can't focus in 10,000 people. They're subsidizing stores. They're talking about 30,000 square foot full service grocery store, a big box store for 10,000 people living in the immediate area. You know, if we look at my ward, it is being somewhat served, but we're looking at grocery operations shutting down, and we need to make sure that the people in this city can experience, again, I'll say it again, because this is what's important. We have a duty to make sure that our residents are able to at least take care of their basic needs in this city. We don't want them to leave this city. This city is growing, it's good, but we need to be cognizant that we have inner city struggles all the time, and it is not the fault of any government. You know, we should just take responsibility. I take issue with anybody who tries to pass this off as it not being a city interest. You know, if we can TIF, if we can provide incentives for football stadiums, for hockey arenas, for baseball diamonds, for all these entertainment things, I don't understand why we can't have a plan to make sure that the basic needs of these people are taken care of. And so I'll be voting against this report to just ditch it and forget about it. And I hope that at some point our leadership from EPC will ask our administration to have a plan just in case, because it's not just downtown where we have this problem. Thank you.
Councillor Gerbasi.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I just wanted to make a few comments about what the motion is in front of us, which Councillor Eady moved and I seconded, which is simply asking Council to consider investigating options to attract grocery stores to areas experiencing a food desert situation. Now, we heard the Mayor, I was surprised to hear him talk about specific potential incentives, and I'm very pleased to hear him talk about that, because I was quite concerned last week when I heard from EPC the comments made that it wasn't something the city should be involved in. But to just clarify what the motion is actually about, it's talking about the city of Winnipeg's downtown and certain shoulder neighborhoods that have seen major grocers close up their operations, such as Zellers at the Bay, Extra Foods on Main and Notre Dame, and Food Fair on Arlington. As the motion states, many residents in these areas do not have access to a motor vehicle. We know that attracting people to live in the core area and in shoulder neighborhoods requires full service options to make their lives comfortable, and I'm pleased that everyone agreed with that today. The motion only asks that Council considers incentives, explores, studies, and these incentives could be zoning incentives or financial, as they've done in New York City, as just one example, and all we're asking is to look at that. Zoning benefits, such as more flexible parking requirements or allowing more residential development under certain zonings, were part of what was done in New York. The idea is to attract grocery stores to specific, targeted, designated areas that are facing these issues. We would obviously need to look at any financial incentives in our local context, as we have with other financial incentives in the downtown to help revitalize the downtown. The comments that were made last week at EPC were that basically council should take a hands-off approach and that we should not be directly involved. It was also stated that this is not a municipal issue. And I'd like to point out on page 80 of Complete Communities, it says, it directs the city to support a mix of commercial services and employment uses that serve the local community. It could be argued that Winnipeg's decision to not get involved, if that is the decision, which I hope it's, this motion seems to indicate that, but I hope it doesn't. It could be argued that Winnipeg's decision to not get involved in creating incentives to address these issues and leaving this as a private business matter is choosing to not support commercial services, in this case groceries, that serve the local community. So once again, our city plan appears to be being ignored. Furthermore, the city's, we know that Center Venture and the Downtown Biz have been working with the residents, have hired a consultant, and are trying to put some ideas together. So, but Center Venture is our own organization. So obviously the comments last week don't make sense because our organization is already involved. The motion is asking that council get involved with that whole community-led process and look at the incentives that we have the authority to give and investigate this more and work with our community partners. That's the intention here, and I think people know that that's how we get things done in this community. So I sincerely hope that when that feasibility study is done by the Downtown Biz, because I have a bad feeling that we're not going to see this motion go anywhere today based on what I've seen so far, that City Council will pay close attention to the results and take some action and essentially do what we are asking for here by exploring how we can help address this. We are partners in neighborhood and downtown revitalization, and we ought to be showing leadership here by considering ideas to address the challenges our downtown neighborhoods face. The city of Winnipeg should not be a passive bystander here. We all know that downtown revitalization is not about any one factor. It's not just about sports teams, an arena, residential development, a pedestrian environment, or services for residents. It's about all of the above, and we are dropping the ball if we do nothing on this issue. So all this motion is asking for is to consider exploring this further, and EPC is saying what we're voting on today is to say, no, we will do nothing at this time. Please understand how disappointing this is for those who care about the vitality of our downtown and inner city, which includes, I would hope, all of us and many, many Winnipeggers, not just those who live in downtown. The residents of downtown are not asleep at the switch, as you've seen this morning. They are very, very organized. I've been at meetings with them. Councillor Smith has been at many meetings with them. And Councillor Edie's been talking to his own constituents. And these people are not asleep at the switch. They are very loud and clear in their message this morning, and I certainly hope Council listens to them. A wise observer said something to me recently, that when the residents of downtown start demanding action, that's when you will see it happen. So I hope that the residents, that this issue will not be sidestepped any further, and you will be hearing from those residents loud and clearly and persistently, and I do sincerely hope that this Council listens. Thank you.
Councillor Swindell, followed by Councillor Smith.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I just want to put a few records, words on the record here. One of the most frustrating things when you deal with something like this is when the politicians in us start to try and create polarity on an issue that's obviously of great importance to these elderly people. And when I listen here to these people as they spoke, I hear a whole bunch of different concepts being put on the table. Some folks saying they want a grocery store that they can walk to indoors. Others folks say they want a grocery store that's within a proximity. Others yet say that there's a grocery store that needs to be there to accommodate a certain amount of population. So what we need to do first and foremost is stop trying to create polarity, stop trying to say EPC's the boogeyman, and anybody who doesn't sit on EPC is the holy savior coming in to solve this problem. And from that, we need to clearly define what the issue is. The issue here is access to groceries. And if you go out outside of some self-serving look where some state or city somewhere has done something that you want to hang your hat on that single item, there are a myriad of solutions to this problem. When you define the problem as access to groceries, Some of them are groceries coming into people. Some of them are transportation taking people out to groceries. Some of it is incentives right in the backyard to have the right range of groceries available at the peak hours. So if you really actually focus on the problem, take a position of true leadership rather than a crass and vulgar method of trying to create some political polarity to serve some other agenda rather than the needs of these poor people, we might actually get somewhere. And the best place to do that is using our economic development people in our downtown. And when you want to look at it as a zone of population, it would actually go outside of downtown. If you want to talk about a cluster of 10,000 people, because the shoulders of downtown might have access to groceries very close to them, whereas the most inner piece of downtown might not. So let's let the people do their work. Let Center Venture do the work. Let the downtown biz do some work, and let some of the other partners out there, NGOs. And Winnipeg Harvest is great when it comes to food issues and access to food, not just as a place for to come and pick groceries up because you can't afford it, but access to food and all kinds of other resources that people require. So there are ways to get this done. We have good people looking at it. We don't need to be creating a political monster out of this. These people need our help, and we need to get something done. So stop the politics, get the job done, deal with the issue, which is access to groceries.
Thanks, Councillor Swindell. Councillor Smith.
Mr. Speaker, I'm not going to give a long speech, but I tell you this. It's a serious problem where there's no grocery store adequate in size to serve the downtown. And there's other areas of the city the same thing. So it seems to me we should be looking at all possible solutions that other cities have adopted. It doesn't mean we have to adopt them, but it gets our minds thinking about what we can be doing to deal with this problem. So, I'm not going to attack EPC or the mayor or anything else. I think we're all wanting to make the downtown feasible and every other area of the city where there is a lack of full service grocery store. So that's my position. I got these people down here. I wanted everyone on council to realize the serious problem that there is. Thank you.
Thanks, Councillor Smith. Any concluding? Oh, Councillor Havoc's back. Anybody else?
Do we have 10 minutes or 2
yeah,
minutes?
Yeah, 10.
10. Okay. I just wanted to put a couple of things on the record, and I do appreciate all the folks who came down today as well. And I understand the importance of having a grocery store. We're seeing grocery stores, smaller stores, closing all over our city or changing hands. For example, in the North End, the food fair, that was a long-standing food fair, it's closed. It's gone out of business. Transcona, Plessis IGA has changed hands, and they were long-time grocers. And I think grocers in general can manage only one or two stores as a manageability issue. So looking to our grocers in the city is really important. But the city needs to focus on what the city is there to do, provide emergency services, provide sewer, water, essential services. We have Center Venture, which I'm pleased to hear is taking this on, making this a priority, and they are charged with our downtown revitalization and improving our downtown district. And so while I hear that it's an important priority for residents who live there, for people visiting to see a grocery store, I have trust that Center Venture will make this a priority, that they will take the efforts. And you know, in a few months from now, there's nothing preventing council from saying, can we see an update? In fact, one of the things that I'm a big proponent of is more council seminars, and perhaps we ask Center Venture to come in and tell us some updates on some of that. And I hope that the mayor would see that as an important priority. I do, agree with the councillors who brought this forward that it would be nice to see this as a priority, but we don't know the myriad of priorities that Center Venture is working on in any detailed manner. And, we've seen success with their involvement in hotels, restaurants, sports centers, arts, housing.
To find out what other places are doing?
And I think it's important that we think about how we see our role and how much detail. It's not our business to be in the grocery business. It is our business to help facilitate a need that may exist. And so I'm not suggesting that we get involved. Therefore, I will not be supporting the motion that the councillors have brought forward. But I do think it is worth revisiting in the form of a council seminar. Thank you.
Councillor Broady.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Just two very quick points. There's two different areas in the city. We've got the downtown, and we've got other areas in the just outside downtown where we've got issues with the with grocery stores. I have full confidence in Center Venture in going out and pitching the notion that there is a market for a downtown grocery store. We saw that with the Zeller store closing, that there's now a market that's untapped, and I do believe that Center Venture is working hard at trying to find a new downtown grocery store in that area, and I hope they're successful. Regarding the deserts and other points, I'd encourage all my council colleagues that represent those areas to go talk to the grocery stores that are there. Go talk to Safeway, find out why they closed the location on Sargent by Aaron or Wall there. You know, there's still a Safeway, I believe, on Selkirk Avenue. Are they at risk? I'd go chat with them. I mean, it's concerning that, you know, Loblaws closed the Extra Foods over on Notre Dame. Do you have any idea why? I'd encourage my colleagues to find out why. If you want, I can make some calls too. I'm curious, and I'd like to know what the backstory is there. Thanks.
Councillor Packman.
Much, Mr. Speaker. I'll be really quick here. Obviously, there's a lot of great discussion going on here regarding the grocery stores. On Monday at Downtown Development and Heritage Riverbank Management, I'll be asking Center Venture to come down, do a quick presentation relative to their strategy and how they're working with other economic development agencies in our city, as well as with the business for a downtown retailing strategy, specifically with the purpose of attracting a downtown grocery store.
Any further comments, questions? Mayor Cates, to close.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I think we know that there's a real issue when it comes to full-service grocery stores. That's number one. Number two, Mr. Speaker, you haven't seen the type of growth we're seeing in our downtown in a long time. You're seeing high-rise apartments for the first time in 2.5 decades, high-rise condos being constructed. I mean, there are people who are coming downtown, and we've always talked about the horse and the carriage or the chicken and the egg. First you need the people, and then you get the amenities, or first you get the amenities, and then the people come, and obviously it's a mix of the two. But the facts are, we know what's needed. We know that Center Venture, that moves a lot quicker than council can, Mr. Speaker, is working on the project. So why anybody would want to be redundant and do it twice is beyond me, other than maybe trying to make points for something. I don't get it, but this is a serious issue and it should be taken. And also, Mr. Speaker, through you to Councillor Gervasi, it's unfortunate that you don't hear all the comments, but my comments are on the record with the media, and that's exactly what I said, Mr. Speaker, that from my point of view, you'd get the building and they pay a percentage of gross, no fixed rent. But the realities are, Mr. Speaker, here is the real issue. We know we need full-time grocery facilities downtown. We've heard a few councillors talk about this need and want to move a motion. I'm curious, how many grocers have they spoken to? I know I've contacted a few and had some serious conversations. This issue has been going on for a while, Mr. Speaker. It's gotten some great media coverage. How many grocers have approached any member of council or yours truly saying, you know what, I'd like to do something? And usually what the private sector does, trying to address one of Councillor Edie's scenario, they come forward with the proposal and they tell you what they need. What, are you going to try and guess what they need? They have to come forward and tell you what you need. So a lot of the dialogue today, I don't know whether it's for show, but it doesn't appear genuine. I think Center Venture is genuine. I believe this council knows there's a scenario out there that needs to be filled, and I believe it will happen. How quickly it'll happen, that's the real question, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you, Mayor Cates. I'm assuming there'll be a recorded vote on this. If so, I'll have to ask Councillor Wyatt to return to his chair. There's a recorded vote. Sorry. All right, all those in favor of the motion, please rise.
His Worship Mayor Cates, Councillors Browati, Fielding, Havixbeck, Mays, Orlico, Pagtikan, Sharma, Steen, Swandell, Vandell, Wyatt, and Mr. Speaker, Councillor Nordman.
All those opposed, please rise.
Councillors Eady, Gerbasi, Smith.
The vote, Mr. Speaker, yeas 13, nays 3.
Motion carries. And that concludes the report for April the 3rd. We will now move to the report of the Executive Policy Committee dated April the 17th.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I will introduce the report and move adoption of the consent agenda items 1 to 3.
Seeing none, all those in favor? Opposed? Carried. We have some bylaws, Mr. Mayor.
I'd like to move that the rule be suspended and that the report of the Executive Policy Committee dated April the 24th of 2013 be considered.
I need a motion, 2/3. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried.
Item 1, first charge against the 2014 Assiniboine Park Conservancy Infrastructure and Sustainability Capital Program.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Speaker, there's only a few things I want to point out. We know the commitment that we've made to the Assiniboine Park Conservancy. We know all the wonderful things that have been happening there. What they have asked for is a first charge, and I want to make it clear this is not new money, this is existing money. So with that being said, if there are any questions, I'd be happy to address them.
Councillor Mays.
More of a comment to the question. I just I'm glad to hear the mayor confirm that this is not new money. I think that's been missed in some of the commentary we've gotten from the public on this. That there was a 10-year commitment. We've also made separate commitments in the operating budget to Assiniboine Park Conservancy. The city's been a big supporter of that group, but this is not money that was going to be spent on roads or bridges or sidewalks. This is part of a $30 million grant over a 10-year period, and we're merely moving some of the money forward into this year and recovering that in the 3 years to follow. So I appreciate the mayor's comments that this, to be clear, this is not some new spending initiative. It's simply accelerating some of the funding in order to get the gate open when the zoo and what we're hoping is a big project, the Churchill project, to have those open at the same time. Thank you.
Thank you. Any further comments? Seeing none, Mayor Cates, close.
Okay.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Now we have bylaws, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I move that bylaw number 55 of 2013 be read a first time.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Bylaw number 55, 2013.
And Mr. Speaker, I move the following bylaws be read a first time. Bylaw number 36 of 2013 and bylaw number 57 of 2013.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Bylaw number 36 of 2013 and bylaw 57 of 2013.
And Mr. Speaker, I move that bylaws number 36 of 2013 and 57 of 2013 be read a second time.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Bylaws number 36, 2013 and bylaw number 57 of 2013.
All those in favor?
Mr. Speaker, I move the rule be suspended and bylaws number 36 of 2013 and 57 of 13 be read a third time and that same be passed in order to be signed and sealed.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried. Question period. Councillor Mays, followed by Councillor Smith.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question pertains to, it sort of arises out of the events that happened in Boston 9 or 10 days ago with their marathon. And we have a great successful Manitoba Marathon here. Councillor Orlico and I met with the Manitoba Marathon folks a few weeks ago, and they expressed some concern that their police budget, that they had heard rumors or reports that the city might be charging them for the police budget for this year. And I know The emergency staff were meeting here the other day on a number of issues, talked about our marathon, and I think we have full confidence that our marathon remains a safe and very important event. But I just was hoping to get the mayor to confirm what his office has said, which is that for this year at least, we will not be charging any police costs to the marathon. That's been the tradition here. That may change in the future, but the city's been a great supporter of the marathon, and I just want to confirm that the city is going to continue to provide the police services for this year as part of the Manitoba Marathon.
Mayor Cates.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Through you to Councillor Mays. As you're aware of, we have many marathons and actually a lot of half marathons as well. I can tell you that I have spoken to the WPS service, and it certainly does put a strain on resources. Quite often we have several events happening the same day. There's walks, there's runs. It's pretty amazing. I don't think anybody ever guessed the type of involvement that takes place now with fundraising for many great causes through these different venues of walks and half marathons and marathons. Specifically, I can tell you that I have been told that it would not be reasonable with the amount of notice that exists right now to change what's existing for the year 2013. So there will be no new charges for this year. But I know the WPS is certainly looking at implementing something for 2014, Mr. Speaker.
Good. Councillor Smith.
Yes, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Mayor, according to the report on consultant assignments for January 1st to December 31st, 2012, item 8 of the EPC report dated April the 13th, under the category other than capital only, the city issued 27 contracts to outside lawyers at a cost of $643,444, or 21% of the total payment for 2012. Is this not a good reason to consider an expansion of the city's legal services department?
Mayor Cates.
First of all, through you to Councillor Smith, I thank you for the question. I guess you could have a debate on which one makes more sense, using more outside and less in, or building a department. The realities are, Mr. Speaker, that we do not have access to the expertise, and in a lot of the projects we do, Mr. Speaker, you need a great deal of expertise on these. Otherwise, it could cost you millions of dollars if there's a mistake in your suit. So from my point of view, in order to protect the citizens and make sure the I's and T's are dotted and crossed and all the little minutiae is dealt with, from my point of view, I think you will see that as a very good investment when you're dealing with projects where we may be spending $20, $50, $250 million.
Okay. Councillor Havick-Speck.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. In efforts to restore some trust and confidence in our budget that was passed, I tried to obtain the number of full-time equivalents that the city has on the payroll as of March 31st, 2013. That number is significant because in our budget books, there is a $13.6 million vacancy management number. Yet, the budget is premised on there being 321 more employees hired this year. Will the mayor tell us and tell citizens how many full-time equivalent employees are actually on the payroll as of March 31st, 2013?
Mr. Mayor?
Mr. Speaker, it's my understanding that this is a question that Councillor Havick-Speck has already asked of the COO and has a written answer to that question. If she wasn't able to interpret it, I would be more than happy to look into it and then basically give her the numbers, but it's my understanding she already has them.
Actually, in my written response, I don't have the actual number, so I would appreciate the mayor getting me that. The increase to ward allowances in the 2013 that was passed that I did not support included an additional $40,000 to all city councillors' ward budgets. During the budget deliberations, the issue of returning the $40,000 arose, at which point it was indicated that if councillors did not want that money, they could return it. I tried, Mr. Speaker, to return the $40,000 that was provided to the Charles Wood Tuxedo Ward. I raised it with the CFO, with clerks, at the Finance Committee, and I even went to Governance Committee, and I was told I could not return it till the end of the year. I was also told by the CFO in an email that this money and any excess money in councillors' budgets goes into a line item called non-specified consultants, a budget item I thought we were attempting to reduce. If councillors legitimately want to try to return this money, will the mayor tell us, is that not ludicrous that we cannot return it?
Mayor Gates.
Mr. Speaker, I'd like to ask Councillor Smith to represent me and answer this one, because I think he addressed it best the last time round. We all know what this is all about, Mr. Speaker. Number one, okay, Councillor Havixbeck was a big supporter of this and changed her mind for whatever her reasons are, and that's up to her, because anybody can change their mind. But let's not pretend. Number two, every single councillor can return any amount of money that they don't use. We all know that. So you know what, if you want to just play a game and put on a show for the public, that's anyone's prerogative. But I think every single councillor knows what this is about. And I'm not going to quote what Councillor Smith said last time, but I did enjoy the quote.
Last question.
Up until about 3 weeks ago, it seemed there was little, if anything, happening towards negotiating some settlement towards having the water and sewer extended into Centreport. In their business plan, which they have produced in hard copy and which is on their website and has been for a number of months, they indicate that by 2015, that would be the first year they would not be government supported by the province and the federal government. I would like to know whether the mayor will provide a council seminar, and it can be in camera, it can be in private, so that all councillors can learn about this very important issue for our city, so that when the information comes to council, we'll be well-versed and have some understanding of some of the negotiations that are going on.
Mayor Gates.
Mr. Speaker, first of all, I was able to get a copy of the COO's email to Councillor Havixbeck. It specifically states 2013 preliminary operating budget financial summary page 1 identifies total FTEs for the public service of 8,763. So if I can read the email that was sent to her, I'm sure she could have as well. Number two, Centreport. I would like to think at this stage of the game that every member of council has some idea of what's been going on at Centreport. The City of Winnipeg was very much prepared to provide services to Centreport the same way we were doing them to West St. Paul. As you know, there has been a lawsuit by Band 39 and then joined by Band 40. And in addition to that, the International Joint Commission has also expressed some concerns. So that's obviously held it up. We still did enter into agreement for sewer services with West St. Paul, and we put that same proposal to Rosser probably, I would say, 6 weeks ago now, Mr. Speaker. It's been a month and a half. I haven't heard anything back. Number two, in addition to that, this issue could easily be resolved, and I know that many of the stakeholders have already come forward and suggested, why are we going through all this? They are basically asking the province to annex that piece of land, because then we could provide all the services immediately. So, but I'll tell you what, I think it's actually not a bad idea to hear from our administration exactly what's going on and exactly see how much the City of Winnipeg has done and is ready to do to make sure this becomes a reality. So you know what? I am going to basically, I'd be happy to see if we can arrange for a council seminar on this issue.
Thank you, Mayor Gates. Councillor Eadie.
Thank you, Speaker Nordman. Yeah, the provincial budget hasn't been passed yet, and I know for some parts of it, it is kind of disappointing that the city didn't find a stream of money. But I'm really concerned, though. What they have done, we passed in our budget a new plan to fix our local streets. And it looks like in this budget that they're offering us up an extra $7 million that they'll put into the plan They're saying we have to match it, but we've already done that. We've invested $10 million new dollars into fixing our local streets. So I just want to be assured that they're calling on the mayor or the mayor's office and our administration to work through how they can help spend their extra $7 million on our local streets. Can I be assured that that the mayor and the administration will work diligently with the local government minister's office to ensure that this extra money gets put into fixing our awful local streets that I've been getting lots of calls on this month?
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Speaker, I'm very confident that Councillor Eadie knows that that is definitely one of our priorities, and we work very hard to address that concern. And I would say we are beyond disappointed. I'll speak for myself. I am beyond disappointed that, and I think Councillor Eadie used so-called $7 million, whether it's real money or not, because sometimes it's very difficult when you analyze budgets. They give money with the right hand, but then take it back with the left hand. But let's just pretend that there's $7 million. It is conditional. It does have to be matched. And more importantly, they get to decide which projects can happen. By the same token, as long as these are good projects, yeah, we want to get as many streets fixed as we possibly can. That certainly is our number one priority.
Follow up.
Thank you. Thank you for the message. And actually, I just want to ask a question. When talking about grocery stores and trying to make them so that they're financially viable, can you please, and you made a comment in the debate that grocery stores need to come to you with their plan. Did Nietzsche Commons bring you a plan and request some sort of way to help them provide groceries to the North End?
Mr. Speaker, I believe Nietzsche Commons number one went to the administration and yours truly and the councillor. We sent it to the admin. It was regarding incremental taxes. I think Councillor Eadie knows the story. As a matter of fact, I actually visited Nietzsche Commons with him.
Last question.
Yes, just wanted to clarify that. Just in regards to that, I know that we're working on a plan or trying to, but would you acknowledge, though, that there is a need for grocery stores and that Centre Venture doesn't deal with anything outside of the downtown boundaries? Is that true?
Mayor Gates.
Mr. Speaker, I think we've already gone on the record and said there is a need. That's number one. Number two, Centre Venture does not represent the North End, obviously. I think we all know that. By the same token, Mr. Speaker, wouldn't it be nice if we came up with a model through Centre Venture's hard work that we could use for other parts of the city if that need arises, and as opposed to trying to figure out on a one-off scenario, and you know that's normally the way things work. So from my point of view, that could be a good initiative. Once Centre Venture consultant finishes doing what they're doing, then they would have a proposal that would come to City Hall, because obviously I think we all know there's going to be an ask. Every major project that's enhanced our downtown through Centre Venture, we've been involved, Mr. Speaker. We're always involved.
Councillor Swindell.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Through you to the mayor, as he's already stated, it would appear that he's not that happy with the provincial budget, and some comments that have come out in the last week or so certainly show that. In particular, it's the 1% provincial sales tax increase. We've heard the province talk about focusing that money on infrastructure, but when they talk about infrastructure, they're very quick to talk about schools, hospitals, and issues around flooding. From my experience, Mr. Speaker, I understand there's already funding models in place for schools, there's funding models and methods in place for hospitals. The flooding is obviously an issue that comes up, and municipalities and the other two levels of government have formulas in place to deal with the issues around flooding. My concern is, and I believe it's the mayor's concern, that we're not going to see this money, and it's a very large amount of money when you put it to the city of Winnipeg, in the perspective of the city of Winnipeg. We're not going to see it drilled down to the roads and bridges that we can all see crumbling around us, and some of the other key pieces of infrastructure. Having said that,
I also am concerned that if we become the political opposition in this, that we might not get what we need. And I'd like to hear some comment from the mayor on whether or not he's had any conversations with the premier about municipalities having a voice at the table of how to spend this money and how to put this money to work, recognizing that there might be some immediate other financial issues that they need to deal with. And if he's considered the newly created Cities Forum of the Association of Manitoba Municipalities as a vehicle to participate in that conversation.
Mr. Mayor?
I think every member of council, Mr. Speaker, will have their opinions, good and bad, on the provincial budget. I can tell you that the morning of the budget, I did speak. The Premier was kind enough to call me, told me a few things, and we left at that, and I thanked him. Unfortunately, as I mentioned earlier, when these budgets are done, we almost have to do a forensic audit to try and determine exactly what we're getting and what we're not getting. Are we getting more or are we getting less? It's a phenomenal task, which is why it's very difficult to respond, you know, an hour after the budget. But the realities are that many municipalities throughout the province are extremely disappointed. As you know, for 2 years now, we've been asking for 1% of existing PST to go to municipalities to deal with the infrastructure deficit. That would represent about $152 million for the city of Winnipeg. And you can imagine what we could do with that. And that's long term, that's every year. What you've seen in the last 12 months, Mr. Speaker, is an increase in taxes of almost $500 million. Almost $500 million. Approximately $184 million with the increase in taxes last year that most people didn't see, whether it's increased motor vehicle, whether it was increase in PST on certain items, but they raised $184 million. And depending who you listen to, in this situation, the PST is somewhere between $277 million to $300 million for 1 year, for a full year. That's just under $500 million, Mr. Speaker. And I know that many municipalities are extremely concerned because they believe this was the only opportunity we would ever have to address our infrastructure deficit. What I would have liked to have seen or heard is, number one, that municipalities are going to get that 1 point. But if that didn't happen, which I believe it should have, at least the dialogue that the provincial government is going to sit down with all municipalities and try and address a long-term solution to the infrastructure deficit. You know, that didn't happen either. But I can tell Councillor Swandell through you, Mr. Speaker, that I have spoken to many mayors in the province. I have spoken to the president of the Association of Manitoba Municipalities, and I can tell you that not happy would be an understatement. By the same token, we still need to move forward and address our crisis situation in infrastructure, and we're going to have to take some form of action, and that is yet to be determined.
Councillor Swandell, follow up.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Speaker. And I hope we're all on the same page of this, but I encourage the mayor and EPC to walk softly for a while, because there is an opportunity here, I believe. We've always advocated for this new revenue, Mr. Speaker, and even the federal government, I believe it was the Prime Minister himself, said when they dropped the GST, I think the comments, and perhaps the mayor can confirm this, where that this now creates the room for the provinces to do something for the municipalities. I want to ask, I'll ask in my two questions on two specific items, and then I know that the Dutch elm disease is something that's very important to a number of us. I think almost maybe all of us represent areas that are greatly affected by Dutch elm disease. We previously put forward in the budget increased funding for
Dutch elm disease, and I believe we left the condition in there on the province being involved, and I don't see, and I've had some conversation with Councillor Vandel, and he's confirmed that he hasn't seen anything in the provincial government that would be that matching funding. I'm just wondering if the mayor can provide us an answer on that, and I have one other item I'll bring up in my final.
Mr. Speaker, as you know, I'm going by memory, but I believe we allocated approximately $1.9 million to address a very serious issue, Dutch elm disease, and we asked the province to match it. As a result of a discussion amongst the councillors, we took our condition out, as I recall, and we moved it forward. I can tell you that there is nothing in the, there's no money in the provincial budget re Dutch elm disease.
Well, thank you. I'd appreciate if there are conversations going forward that that could be brought up. My final question, Mr. Speaker, is relative to existing projects and our operating expenses at the City of Winnipeg. We have not included in any of our budgets this additional 1% of PST. So this is going to create an expense for us in the very near future. I'm sure there has been times where the provincial sales tax has been raised before and they've dealt with projects that are already on the go in municipalities or large joint projects. I'm wondering if the mayor, as this moves forward, can take this issue up specifically to the additional costs. At any given time, I think we have around $500 million of open capital projects, accumulated over some previous budgets. Not all of that's going to be taxable under the PST, but a large portion of it is. And certainly we're spending PST, we get a GST rebate, but we still don't get a PST rebate on this. So it's something that budget-wise we need to be very cognizant of, and perhaps the mayor can give us some insight as to where he might be going on that particular issue.
Mr. Speaker, it's my understanding based on projections and speaking to the Chief Financial Officer that if this budget passes and there's an increase from 7 to 8%, that would cost the city approximately $1.4 million. That's number one, which is why I say give with one hand and take away with the other hand. I think everybody knows that the Association of Manitoba Municipalities, as well as this council, has asked on numerous occasions that the provincial government refund the City of Winnipeg our PST, which I believe was just under $12 million. It's obviously going to be higher now. Very similar to the way the federal government refunds the GST, and I think so far that's definitely fallen on deaf ears. The answer has been no. In addition to that, I'd be happy to share with the rest of council is that in previous budgets, the provincial government, I'm sure most people here have heard the expression PILT, payment in lieu of taxes. When the federal government, provincial government has buildings, they pay taxes, they're called payment in lieu of taxes, and it's a payment. The provincial government in this budget has basically wiped that out, so they will not be paying their taxes, and they're now calling it a grant. So once again, we're not really getting any more money, they just shifted over to grants. So you can see why it's so difficult to analyze a budget and come up with a bottom line of what are you getting and what aren't you getting. But those two examples show $7.4 million, which no longer exists.
Councillor Wyatt.
On the same line of questioning regarding the budget, Mr. Mayor, back in 2008, a motion moved by myself, seconded by Councillor Steeves, was passed by this council, calling on, with regards to the AMM, that the City of Winnipeg is faced with infrastructure deficit, that we were in need of new funding solutions, and calling for the creation of a 1% municipal sales tax as a support of an AMM motion that went forward to that fall convention, which, by the way, was defeated after the provincial government publicly stood up and chastised the municipalities for proposing a 1% sales tax to go towards and dedicated to infrastructure at the time. The media soundly attacked municipal officials across this province and little newspapers everywhere, and the delegates of the convention defeated the resolution. However, another resolution with regards to requesting a share of the existing sales tax was proposed and passed. That was supported and been lobbied on for the last number of years. You and others in the business community have even talked lately of the idea of a municipal infrastructure levy, and let us take the responsibility of having a referendum. In light of the development, Mr. Mayor, that we now have a provincial government which has brought forward an increase in the sales tax, nobody could have expected, not only wiping out their balanced budget legislation by removing the requirement for a democratic referendum, which we all thought was an absolute requirement, Mr. Mayor, and the fact that we're only getting $7 million out of $278 million, most of the revenues generated by Winnipeggers here in the city of Winnipeggers, shopping here in Winnipeg. What are we going to do, Mr. Mayor, with the growing infrastructure deficit and the fact that the province government, the provincial government, and the premier of this province has clearly abandoned the city of Winnipeg and its infrastructure crisis that we're facing today? What is the strategy, Mr. Mayor? What are we going to do?
Mayor Cates.
The name is Sam. I'm not all-knowing, all-loving, and all-powerful, Mr. Speaker. The realities are, Mr. Speaker, how many times have you heard me say to you in the media, we have a crisis situation when it comes to our infrastructure? There are many other mayors saying the same thing. We talk about our streets. The citizens know how bad they are, driving on our streets, walking on our sidewalks. We have swimming pools that are falling apart and closed right now. We have parkades that are in the same situation, they're not safe. We need significant investment in libraries, in community centers, in fire hall and paramedic stations, police stations. The list goes on and on and on and on, Mr. Speaker. And the realities are, you can't do that with property taxes. What I find interesting is that, the amount of debate that we had, it would be for a 1% property tax increase, okay, open to the public, and the public can make presentations and delegations. And yet, as was said earlier, approximately $300 million on PST, we have no say, no input, no delegations. The same thing for $184 million. I don't really understand it, but the realities are, it is what it is. And this council is going to have to find a solution to a very, very serious problem, because it appears the provincial government isn't interested. I only say that because of their actions. The actions speak loud. So as a result of that, this council is going to have to find a solution. And I can tell you this much, it's not going to be easy. Some very, very difficult decisions will have to be made in the near future if we truly want to get this infrastructure problem addressed. And with all due respect, when you talk about supposedly $7 million, okay, supposedly $7 million of new money, and then you talk about a $7.4 billion infrastructure deficit, Mr. Speaker, where are you going? What are you going to accomplish? The reality is very little, and the sad part, it just gets worse, and the price keeps going up, Mr. Speaker. Now, I could continue to talk, but I think Mr. Councillor Wyatt may have another question, so I'll give him that opportunity.
Councillor Wyatt, follow up.
No, I welcome the mayor's comments and the fact that, yes, there's no doubt there's going to be some tough decisions to be made. Mr. Mayor, last year you proposed a menu of items to the premier. You wrote him a letter before his budget suggesting different ideas. One of them was to raise gas taxes. He did it. He kept the money. Previous to that, you suggested that he look at the option of vehicle registrations. He raised it. He kept the money. And now, after years of lobbying for a sales tax, he's raising it. And out of $278 million, $7 million is coming back to the citizens of Winnipeg. It's the largest single tax grab in the history of this province by this government. Mr. Mayor, what are we going to do as a city? I'll ask the question again, in terms of addressing the challenge we're facing now with this provincial government, who has abandoned the city of Winnipeg.
Mayor Cates.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I think the first thing I should do is send a consulting bill to the provincial government, because they've taken every idea we put on the table and used it for their own benefit, but c'est la vie. Mr. Speaker, I wish I could answer Councillor Wyatt's question. you know, what are we going to do? I know the seriousness of the infrastructure crisis. I believe many members of council do. I don't know if everybody else really, really understands it, but I'll tell you what, 10 years from now, there's going to be chaos as a result of this. Something's got to give, and unfortunately, you know, there was that opportunity with getting, you know, something of the existing. Now that it's increased, you would think that was even more likely, but they've said no to that. And those are the kinds of dollars you need to generate over a long period of time to actually start getting the work done. I mean, with all due respect, you know, $7 million and cut it. I don't know. I am genuinely concerned. I am concerned about, you know, my children, the grandchildren, what's going to happen here, and how this issue will ever get addressed, because I don't think it will if somehow we're not able to do it. But I'm not in a position, as I stand here before Councillor Wyatt and the rest of council, to tell you exactly what we need to do to get the job done. I had many ideas, which I've sent, you know, through emails and letters to the Premier and the provincial government. They certainly liked the ideas and they took the money, so I don't know what else we can do, but we need to do something, that I know for sure, and this council is going to have to figure it out, and it's not going to be easy, and it's not going to be fun.
Thank you, Mayor Cates. That concludes question period.
Me or you?
All right, we'll move on to the Standing Policy Committee for Infrastructure Renewal and Public Works. April 16th meeting, three items.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'd like to move items 1 to 3 of the Infrastructure Renewal and Public Works meeting dated April 16th, 2013.
Seeing no stand downs, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. We have a couple of bylaws, it looks like. Yes.
I'd like to move that the following bylaws be read a first time. Bylaw number 58-2013, bylaw number 60-2013.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried.
Bylaw number 58-2013 and bylaw number 60-2013.
I'd like to move that bylaws numbered 58-2013 and 60-2013 be read a second time.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Bylaw number 58-2013 and 60-2013.
I'd like to move that the rules be suspended and bylaws numbered 58-2013 and 60-2013 be read a third time, and that same be passed and ordered to be signed and sealed.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried. And we have question period for Infrastructure Renewal Public Works. Councillor Mays to Councillor Vandell.
Getting this off. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Question for Councillor Vandell, more by way of follow-up to get an answer perhaps for the Infrastructure Committee. There was a CBC story the day or two ago in regard to a homeowner in Winnipeg who is pipes had frozen while he was away for the winter and his furnace had gone out, house flooded. None of that's necessarily our concern, but it indicated in the body of the story he was facing a $13,000 water bill from the city, and I had a resident from my ward call and say, is there some policy, is there some time over which an individual can repay that? I don't know. Councillor Smith has indicated that he believes there was some policy to that effect in the past, so given that we've been accused of having an empathy deficit here at the City of Winnipeg, I thought I would ask that to Councillor Vandell if we could follow up. We can't take full responsibility for something like this, but a $13,000 water bill is a pretty hefty sum for a homeowner to face. So just like to see if the Councillor could follow up on that.
Thank you, Councillor Mays. Through you, Mr. Speaker, to the Council. I'm not aware of the details of the situation, but I know that we're having an infrastructure renewal meeting on Tuesday morning, the 30th of April. That's certainly something we can discuss with the directors there to see what sort of precedents there are, what the situations are for, you know, at the very least, or just looking at the situation in more detail to see what it is we can do. I think I'll leave it at that, not knowing really what the details are. Thank you.
Councillor Havixbeck.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Main Street is one of our routes and I'm talking about Main Street closest to our downtown area, that part of is in the downtown, where the Arts and Culture District exists, and we spend a lot of time and money trying to beautify that street. I was wondering, I know with our current garbage and recycling collection system that it is very regimented on the days that pickup can occur. However, there are many business owners and people who are on Main Street who put their garbage out on Friday or Saturday for a Monday collection. And on a street that we're trying to keep beautiful, can the chair tell us, could some flexibility be made for certain situations like that?
Councillor Van Dell.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I certainly will take the question under advisement. I'll speak to our water and waste people to get, again, some details on the situation. I'm not, and talk to the councillor to see that I'm reflecting her question properly. And it's all in our best interest to keep the downtown clean. I'm a big proponent of a downtown first policy, and certainly can commit to doing everything we can to keeping the downtown clean.
Any other questions for Public Works Infrastructure? Seeing none, that'll move the agenda along quickly. We have a Standing Policy Committee on Finance. No report, no motions, no bylaws. Do we have any questions for the Standing Chair of Finance? Councillor Gerbasi.
Speaker, I just wanted to ask, in the budget this year, there was a commitment from the chair for a new budget process that was supposed to start early in the year. It's already the end of April now, and I guess I'm just wondering if you can update us on the status of that. Is there a consultant being hired? What's going to be happening?
Fair question. Budget is, there was an RFP that was issued. It closed the middle of this month. We've had a number of submissions. There was a meeting only on Monday of this week where staff review the various submissions, and a selection should be made, and an announcement in terms of what the consultations will look like, who's selected, what they will look like, and how it will involve council as well. So that should be happening shortly. Just to say, Mr. Speaker, I think it could have happened sooner, but what happened in terms of my own situation, and unfortunately it did affect that, and I'm sorry for that, Mr. Speaker, but we're on top of it. It's moving, and I think we'll be able to do that pretty soon. The ideal would be to do the consultation prior to the summer months of July and August, and involve members of council. So thanks for the question, Councillor Gervasi.
Any further questions for finance? Seeing none, we'll move on to the Standing Committee of Downtown Development, Heritage, and Riverbank Management. Councillor Packagan.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I am pleased to introduce the report of April 11th and move consent items 1 and 2.
Oh, Councillor Vandell. You're standing down number 1? Fair enough.
Yeah.
Okay, we'll vote on number 2. Okay. All those in favor of number 2?
Aye.
Those opposed? Item number 1.
Item number 1, Heritage Conservation Grant for St. Boniface Cathedral, 190 Avenue de la Cathedral.
Mr. Speaker, I put my thanks on the record to the citizens that are here this morning. I want to do it again at this time, because this is entirely citizen-driven. There's an impressive group of people that have committed to raising $6 million for a capital campaign for the St. Boniface Cathedral, which is a cultural, it's not only the spiritual and the religious center for the Catholic Church, and not only St. Boniface, but for all of Manitoba, as far as I'm concerned. But it's also a cultural icon for the entire city. I don't know how many landscape shots we've seen of Winnipeg with the cathedral there. And it's important as a city to reinvest in these sorts of architectural, cultural icons. And I think we need to continue to do a great job of finding the resources to invest in these sorts of gems. So I want to thank the chair of downtown for championing this through the process, and of course I want to thank the mayor and executive committee, and it sure would be nice to see this approved unanimously. Thank you.
Councillor Mays.
Well, I wasn't going to stand this down, but Councillor Vandell did, so I just want to say two things. I want to commend the Councillor Vandell for being a champion of this as well, and this is an institution, the cathedral, whose history goes back into the 1800s in Winnipeg. And I know that because my late father translated the poem about the voyageurs coming to the cathedral. He translated that into French. I would commend anyone to see that. It's in the St. Boniface Museum, which is another important resource for our history. So the history of the cathedral is a long one, and I want to commend the councillor for championing this, and certainly I'm supportive.
Seeing no further comments, Councillor Pachter, any comment? Go ahead with the vote. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Thank you. We have no motions, no bylaws. Do we have a question for the chair for Downtown Development, Heritage, and Riverbank? Seeing none, we're moving right along. Standing Policy Committee for Property and Development, Councillor Broaddy.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'd like to introduce the report of April 9th, 2013, and move adoption of the consent agenda items 1, 2, 8.
Seeing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried.
I move that the following bylaws be read a first time: bylaw 51 of 2013, 52 of 2013, 53 of 2013, 54 of 2013, 59 of 2013, and 61 of 2013.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried.
Bylaw numbers 51 of 2013, 52 of 2013, 53 of 2013, 54 of 2013, 59 of 2013, and 61 of 2013.
I move that bylaws numbered 51 2013 to 54 2013, both inclusive, bylaw 59 2013, and bylaw number 61 2013 be read a second time.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried.
Bylaw numbers 51 2013 to 54 2013, both inclusive, and bylaws number 59 of 2013 and 61 of 2013.
Councillor Broaddy.
I move that the rule be suspended in bylaws numbered 51 2013 to 54 2013, both inclusive, bylaw number 59 2013, and bylaw number 61 2013 be read a third time, and that the same be passed in order to be signed and sealed.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Question period for property and development. Yikes. Councillor Gervasi, Smith, and Sharma. Go ahead.
I apologize to Councillor Smith if he was going to be asking about this, because I know it was an issue he wanted to bring up earlier. I just wanted to make sure it does get brought up, and I'm sure he may have further questions. But in any case, the Sherbrooke Pool is in Councillor Smith's ward, but it also affects many constituents of mine and many other councillors. So I just wanted to make sure we didn't not ask this question today. For the councillors that have affected residents, which are throughout the city, but in particular those closer, like some of us, we are completely in the dark. We've been told since this whole issue happened with the Sherbrooke Pool closing for months and months and months, next week, next week, next week, next week, we have been told no information. And I understand right now, the most I can figure out from putting on my Sherlock Holmes hat, is that this is in the hands of EPC at this time, politically deciding how to bring the report forward or having input into it or something. So I would like to ask the chair of property if he will inform all members of council, if not here, in a council seminar or something, as soon as possible, so that we can stop telling our constituents we don't have a clue because we haven't been told anything, as months and months go by and there is a report that we've been told is finished from the administration's point of view and is, I guess, being looked at politically. Thank you.
Councillor Broaddy.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. As we know, the unfortunate circumstances last November required an immediate closure of the Sherbrooke Pool to ensure the safety of the users. That was the right thing to do. It needed to be done, and I commend the public service for making the tough decision at that time. I understand some engineering research and that has been ongoing. I haven't seen the actual work, but I believe the work is complete and is in the hands of our public service. Again, the mayor has committed $200,000 from his office budget to ensure that the right research and that work is being done, and I commend Mayor Cates for making sure that that work is going on. My understanding is in the coming days and weeks we will have a recommendation from the public service, and we'll be proceeding to have that discussion at that time.
Follow up.
That's pretty much the answer I've been getting, and I understand there must be a report that's finalized. I guess you're saying that the area councillor and the councillors that are most affected by this closure are going to have to wait till that report is made public, or are you prepared to inform us and brief us or have the staff brief us on this matter in detail with some meaning to it other than, you know, that there's a report coming? Because I've been hearing there's a report coming for a long time, and I believe it was written quite some time ago.
Councillor Brody.
I understand community services has as well provided additional opportunities for people in the area to use other services. Apparently there are bus and shuttle services that allow people from that immediate neighborhood to use other facilities for free public swim classes. They've done whatever can be done to accommodate that area. So again, there definitely will be further consultation and communication, whether it's going to be a rehabilitation of the existing facility, whether it's going to be rebuilding or providing other amenities to the community. That there's still going to be lots of time to have a good public conversation about this and include all the stakeholders in the neighborhood, the area councillors, as well as the users of Sherbrooke Pool and the broader community.
Well, Mr. Speaker, on the radio yesterday, where there were a number of those very users talking about how they may appreciate there's been other facilities, but they aren't adequate, they aren't meeting the needs. The Sherbrooke Pool is needed, and the councillors who represent those people have been left in the dark. So I guess I'm still not feeling I'm hearing an answer that we're going to know anything until this report is made public, which is not really including members of council and inform so that we can inform our constituents and understand this issue. So I don't know if there's anything else you can say. But.
Everything happens in due course. I appreciate the frustration of the community wanting to have some resolution as to what is going to be happening. I just ask for a little more patience in the forthcoming report. I did hear the interview on CBC yesterday afternoon as well. And again, I do understand the public service, specifically Mr. Ian Day, has been in contact with the Friends of Sherbrooke Pool, and they'll certainly be part of the release of this information. They'll be certainly apprised of it as well.
Councillor Smith.
I don't want to give a lengthy speech on this topic, but let me ask you directly, Councillor Barretti, when do you expect that report to be available for us?
Councillor Smith, I don't have that information for you right here. I will endeavor to get you a response today. I understand soon.
Councillor Sharma.
Thank you. Mr. Speaker, recently an expression of interest was posted for the lease of a restaurant in the Pegwas Pavilion at Kildonan Park. The EOI closed on March 4th, and it's really exciting, Mr. Speaker, that we have embarked on such a process, because users of this flagship park have waited a very long time for this amenity, and the hope is to have some longevity there. And that will come with a strong, solid tenant and a good business plan. Can the chair give us an update on how things are progressing, and when can we expect to see this matter at council?
Councillor Brody.
Thank you very much. I'd like to thank the councillor for a question. Like Councillor Sharma, the park's actually in Councillor Edie's ward, is it not? I'm also a neighbor of the of Kildonan Park, and a lot of my constituents certainly do enjoy using Kildonan Park. My understanding is there will be a report coming forward to the May 9th meeting of the Standing Policy Committee on Property and Development with a proposal for the awarding of the new service provider inside the Pegwas Pavilion, and I'm really hopeful that provider can be up and running for the summer season.
Any further questions for Property and Development? Oh, follow-up from Councillor Sharma. Yeah.
So you're hopeful that we'll be open for the summer, or can we get some more assurance that we will be open for the summer, because the constituents have been without such an amenity for a few years now?
Again, I do know the department has completed the remedial works that needed to be done on the Pegwas Pavilion. I believe that work is complete. So I don't know of any draw. I mean, unless there's it comes down to council making the decision. It's a multi-year contract. Pending council approval, I see no reason that it can't be open for the summer. And again, the ability of the provider to set up.
Seeing no further questions, we'll move on from property and development to protection and community services. Councillor Fielding.
Sure, thank you, Mr. Speaker. I would like to introduce report and move adoption of council consent agenda item number 2.
and that's of course from the March 13th, I'm sorry, March 11th report.
Seeing no comments, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried.
I'd also like to move, Mr. Speaker, the introduction of report and move adoption of consent agenda item number one, and that's from April 8th, 2013 report.
Okay, now I need two-thirds. I need a two-thirds support of this. So this is item two of April 8th.
The community center.
Item one.
Okay, item one. All in favor? Opposed? Carried. Okay. No motions, no bylaws. Question period for protection and community services. Councillor Havixbeck.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. First, I'd like to start by thanking the chair for answering my questions from last month by way of his email this morning. I appreciate those answers. I'd like to know, in the 2013 budget, the city approved, or the council approved, one new school resource officer. I'd like to know what school division that school resource officer has been allocated towards.
Yeah, I believe it's St. James, if I'm not mistaken, but I can verify that and get back to you if you like. I believe it's St. James, though.
Second question, follow-up?
Yeah, continuing on that, I believe, but perhaps the chair could answer better, school resource officer program in our city is a tripartite funded agreement between the city, the school divisions, and the province. And the chair may correct me if I'm wrong, but I do believe that no new monies were allocated in the provincial budget towards the school resource officers. He could clarify that. And then if that is in fact true, that the province has not allocated their share, how would we proceed with that one new SRO?
Councillor Fielding.
I'm not aware that they did provide some funding in their provincial budget for it. I can find out. With that, now the program obviously is in place. I know Councillor Edie's talked a little bit about this before. I think the program is a good program that's there. There's obviously commitments from all levels or a number of levels of government to make this a reality. That's a good question. If they haven't committed the dollars, then we'd have to see. I'm pretty comfortable with our financial contribution to the program right now. I think that there's a lot of needs in the police portfolio. It's obviously a growing budget line, but you know what, we get good value for our dollars too with policing. They're stepping in front of bullets to save people. We know what's going to be going on in summer. So I'm fairly comfortable with the funding models that are in place, but we have to verify if the province did commit these dollars or not to the program.
Councillor Havixbeck.
Thank you. The third part of that would be whether the chair knows that the Winnipeg Police Service does indeed identify the St. James area as the priority, or it is in fact another school division. So I would appreciate if he doesn't know the answer to that, if he could get me that.
Absolutely.
Councillor Nordman.
Hi, thank you, Deputy Speaker Steen. I'm here to report on governance. And there's one item one.
The speaker did.
Okay. Well, I stood it down. I just wanted to do some explanation. So my apologies, Councillor Swandell. I'll have you out of here by 12. just so you know, the Governance Committee. All right. Fair enough. The Governance Committee, each one of the five community committees is represented there, and we looked at the statistical information from the 2011 census once it was crunched, and it turned out, just by coincidence, but my particular ward was not the only one that didn't meet the threshold of 25% above or 25% below. And recognizing that reality of the expense of a new boundaries commission and having just sort of tweaked St. James Brooklyn's several years ago, the same scenario would have had to have happened for St. Charles Ward. So recognizing that there'll be a census again in 2016, that our recommendation is that we leave boundaries as they stand and review them again in after the 2016 census, when particularly St. Norbert will have a fairly large development closer to being built out, and the population of that area may change. So I'll ask your support to review this and go forward to 2016 or 2017 when we next review our boundaries and actually establish a commission to review it.
Councillor Swandell.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Chair. I just want to make a few comments here. I think we've got a bit of a failure on our hands here, but it doesn't seem like we're willing really to pay attention to it. We've got a great gap in the populations in our wards. We're referring here to, I believe, 2010 census data. There's other information at our disposal. In particular, just our building permits information will provide you with a better understanding of what the population growth has and is continuing to do, whether it be in the St. Boniface Ward, the St. Patel Ward, or the St. Norbert Ward. And I believe even in the north end of the city was one of the wards, I think it was Councillor Sharma's ward, was growing and still continues to grow. So we could have used some of that information. We could have done something more here. We don't need to add more wards in order to deal with the inequity. And I think, you know, this seemed to talk about addition of wards rather than how to get a more equitable distribution. And, you know, we do have that ability. And most of that information was already garnered because we could see this coming in the 2009 review or 2010. The 2009 ward boundaries review, we could see this coming, and the commission made comment about it, and certainly heard a lot of representation, and had the specific information on historic boundaries, geographical issues, and so that information was already at our fingertips. So, it doesn't seem like unless you're one of the ones that are greatly affected by this, that there's a great desire to do anything, but I think it is leaving a bit of a disparity here, and so it's unfortunate that we're going to go in this direction, but. That would appear to be the way it's going to be, and I just wanted to put those comments on the record.
Councillor Nordeman.
I'll ask for your support on this governance committee issue. Thank you.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried. So, Councillor Smith, move the meeting to adjournment. And the council now adjourn. Roll call.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, Councillor Steen, His Worship, Mayor Cates, Councillors Rawati, Eady, Fielding, Gerbasi, Havixbeck, Mays, Orlico, Pagtakan, Sharma, Smith, Swandell, Vendel, Wyatt, and Mr. Speaker, Councillor Norman.